I might be faster on two, actually. Good evening. My name is Eric Peterson. And I just have what's kind of a long question, because I conceptually support redevelopment, but I'm wondering at what cost this would be. One of the things mentioned was selling off surplus property. And a lot of that property could be made into low-cost parks, and we have a desperate need for more park space. Just one example, we don't have a dog park, and it's miles and miles to the nearest one that I'm aware of. And it would be in our better interest to take a really hard look at this, just to see if it's worth it, and maybe kind of gamble and hope that the court decision goes our way. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric. Okay, anyone else? Okay, back to council. Jill?
Well, admittedly, this may not be the expertise of council, but it certainly is the expertise of staff. And when we look at the fact that 83% of the redevelopment agencies in the state of California are going to be part of the opt-in program, I think that we are going to be in good company. And I think really when we look at what Matt talked about is really the financial impacts of not opting in, that would be a real loss for the city. Those are real dollars that build housing, and we need to be a part of the program. So I'm certainly going to support it. Thank you.
Okay. Sergio.
Yeah, for me, this issue is very simple. There's the haves and the have-nots. Redevelopment, if it wasn't for redevelopment, we wouldn't have the bread box. That is the only recreational center in that whole entire area where, at least in my district, there's 34,000 people. 24,000 of those live within 15 city blocks. That's the highest density and population in the United States. That's very significant. Some of the housing is at least built prior to 1910. And then they don't look like some of the homes that are in the better areas of the city. They're very old, they're very run down, they have really bad infrastructure. If it's not for redevelopment, that's why I asked if we had identified any additional resources or funds to pay for that, nobody's gonna come in there and say, I'm gonna rebuild your community. It's through redevelopment that we have been able to address that. Housing for seniors. You know, the industry is pretty good about using the young workforce, but that workforce gets old and eventually has to retire and has no retirement, and then they don't even have a place to live because the families either move on or whatever. It's because of that redevelopment funding that we're able to build up affordable housing for people with disabilities, for seniors, for young people now. And so that's the opportunity for families to get started and to be able to go into neighborhoods that they're not as privileged as some neighborhoods. I'd yet to see, when these issues come to this council, I'd yet to see that person that lives in one of those houses that don't have no doors, or they have no heaters, or they have the roofs that are leaking. I don't see none of them lining up and telling us and screaming at us, because they pay their fair portion of taxes just like everybody else, and maybe even more because they don't have businesses and they don't have all these other tax breaks that people do. And we're not even talking about the people that they're not able to claim their income tax returns or unemployment or everything else. These people don't get any of those things. And so to be able to say, I have my house, my street looks fine, I don't have any problems, and to say, forget about everybody else, let them live, the longest they live on the other side of the bridge and the longest I don't see them, and not to care about that, and to say redevelopment needs to go away and to opt out and to do all that. You know, it's not just about being able to go to school, it's being able to live in a home where you can safely and healthy, in a healthy way, grow up, and you can be able to go to school. It's more important. One of the reasons kids fail to go to school is because they don't have a place to live. because they have to move in with other families, some other area, so they stop going to school. That might be hard to understand for some of you because you have a little bit of privileged life. Not everybody has had that kind of life. And so I support redevelopment. I'm gonna continue to support it, and we should do everything we can to do that because we have to be able to take care of those communities that are not as privileged as others. And the day that I see people lining up from my district screaming that we need to stop this, that's when I will start considering that. For now, everybody's saying, businesses, residents, schools, and everybody else is saying, we need to do it. It'd be nice to give everybody more money. It'd be nice if the state wouldn't take so much money from us, because we're doing a good job of administering the funds, and some of you keep coming back here saying we're doing a bad job. The city's not bankrupt. The city's functioning. The city's providing some quality services and moving around some very tough issues, which is the juvenile crime and gangs and all that. So I think we're doing a good job, but that's you know, if you disagree, that's fine. Bottom line, redevelopment is good. We need to preserve it. You know, if you want to be the first one to go tell those kids that their recreational center, the only one they have, that's going to be up for sale because another five other people from another agencies decide to get rid of it, I would like you to be there with me to explain that to people, or to say that we're not going to build affordable housing for seniors. So I support this, Mayor. I think it's a good thing for our city to do. We have done a good job. One of the things that the state auditor did is reviewing every single redevelopment agency. And guess what? We have a good clean health bill because there's no issues here. There's no misuse of funds. There's actually some very good examples. They have national awards for the way monies were used and how monies were leveraged. And those were with CHISPA, with South County Housing, with a lot of good projects that we have done. So we have national recognition. If this council would have made bad decisions and staff would have given us bad advice, we would be dealing with other, like other cities that are facing criminal charges because that's misused taxpayers' funds. So I think we've done a good job and we should continue doing a good job with redevelopment.
Thank you, Sergio. Steve, anything? Kimberly?
Just to echo Councilmember Sanchez's sentiment, being also on the Redevelopment Agency Subcommittee and recognizing on the north end of town and realizing that we have housing. I live in a condo complex that was built in 1980. And when you're talking about long-term planning for your city, it's starting to go into disrepair as we speak. And so how do you plan 45 years out for your city? And part of that is through your redevelopment agency. I have a tendency to disagree with how the state is going about doing it. I think it's perfectly acceptable to call it an extortion cost or a ransom for that matter, but fully support it, willing to make the motion on it, and hope that we can move forward with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Kimberly.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, thank you.
And redevelopment, I mean, District 4, there's a lot of redevelopment that we've done in District 4. The senior housing, CHISPA, I mean.
That's introduced.
Okay. We have not misspent money. So I am supporting what staff is recommending. I, you know, Don, you've done a great job, and I mean, you've worked hard in that area, in redevelopment, you and Mr. Stump, which I don't see him here. But anyways, we need to keep redevelopment, and we need to expand it.
Okay.
Before I get to Steve, just for the record, as excited as we all are to vote, personally, I'd like to do that because it's kind of fun. We're only introducing the ordinance tonight. No, that's all right. So we're introducing, and we'll come back later for the exactly as it were. So yes, we have now we dipped our toe in the water. Councilmember McShane.
Okay, I think my position on redevelopment's been pretty consistent, and that would be to oppose what's being put forward here. I realize I'm the lone wolf on this. I think the overhead and the redirection of monies that could go other places, certainly given where the state's at, sort of backs up what I'd say. I think we have a lot of tools at our disposal as a city, and we need to think about what those tools are and what how they could be used. There's a long list that were just sent to me in an email. Certain jurisdictions, Sanger, California is one, for example, that went on a holiday for all of their permitting fees to encourage development. There's a lot of options out there. The fact that this is an extortion is a bit alarming. There's a lot of emotion and excitement for redevelopment. It's very near and dear to people's hearts, certainly folks that have served longer than I have on this council. And I think to jump into this with, you know, more than half the council already ready to sign on the dotted line, even though we're only introducing it, worries me. I think we need to consult the experts on staff. We're talking about things that are literally just unfolding only days ago. It turns out that as of Thursday, there was some pretty landmark news that influenced this process. And my question to staff yesterday was, well, will there be more news that comes the day after next or the day after that? And that could happen. So I think we need more time. I wouldn't feel comfortable voting on this next week. What I would feel comfortable with is challenging our staff to really do the nuts and bolts analysis. Matt's more than proven himself. Jill's point that this could be a difference between a $21 million or an $11 million hit over the lifetime of the Sunset District, or even in the next number of years, is a big decision to weigh in. So given this legislation, given the predicament that the courts have put this whole issue in, we could very well be in a kind of choose the worst of two evils. So I think that some serious number crunching needs to be done, and we need to be prepared with that analysis to make the best decision in the interest of the city. So I look forward to that.
Okay, Jill, one last comment.
Just a very quick comment. I just want to make sure that everybody understands, at least on the council, that this issue has come before the Finance Committee several times. I just don't want anyone to think that this is not something that's brand new to us, that it has come before the Finance Committee. And today, we did get the net benefit of opting in was going to be well over $10 million of benefit to the city. So that was really critical information.
Okay, a couple things. There is nothing new here. The reality is the city has been embarked by consensus for a number of years now as redevelopment is one of the primary tools to help attract investment into this city, which has an emphasis on city-centered growth. I think one could easily make the case that redevelopment has in fact kept some momentum within the city until the private sector has been willing to re-engage. And all you have to do, you know, I often hear nothing's happening on the 100 block, but that's not really true. There is a Maya Cinema, there is a National Steinbeck Center. There has been activity. I think it is important to note that the city of Salinas, and I think this speaks to Councilmember Sanchez's point, the city of Salinas absorbed and annexed the Alice Al in the 1960s. So this is fundamentally two cities. So when we talk about a large percentage looking for expansion, the reality is there were different zoning issues out there, there was different density issues, and there is a need for tools to attract investment. And again, if anyone is paying attention to the capital markets, money is not coming freely. So sometimes government is the vehicle to make things happen, particularly in the housing area. It is time to lay to rest the notion that there is an equation between incremental dollars that would not otherwise exist and taking money from schools. Creating dollars that eventually go to schools is what redevelopment does. There is no correlation. Keeping it simple, that's just not a correct interpretation of how redevelopment works. It doesn't work. The dollars would never exist. Education's best play is for a community to move forward, attract investment, expand tax bases, improve quality of life, and draw a new business. That's how education wins. Education does not win just because they want or need more money, which we all want them to have. So that simply needs to be laid to rest. There is no
relationship between redevelopment and education in the manner that it is typically presented. And, you know, I, continue to, folks can't have it both ways. City services cannot be achieved by cutting our way to maintaining services or expanding services. We have to expand our tax base. This is one of the critical tools to do this. And I would point out that one of the things that the subcommittee that Councilmember Sanchez and Craig are involved in has brought in all of the community and representatives from the community, whether it's SUBA and the educational community. This council knows full well that in order to move redevelopment expansion forward, we have to be in a good collaborative position with education. We fully understand the facts have to support what I just said in order for the educational community to embrace expanded redevelopment. And I think this council has been extremely conscientious when they agreed to move forward to looking at the possibility of expand. It's been transparent, it's been community-based, it's been multiple stakeholder-based, and it does rely on a clear consensus. That will be the only way the state is going to work with us. And lastly, it is an extortion payment. It is. There's no question about it. The state has been outed. The minute they said, if you opt in, we let you keep your redevelopment agencies, they're outed. It's another form of a take. Three times the voters have been asked to weigh up or down what should the state stay away from local resources. So the first time, the answer was yes, but forgot to cross the T and dot the I. The second time, crossed the T, forgot to dot the I. Third time, dotted the I. That was the last go around. So the state came up with a very clever proposition. If we can't take, then we'll put you out of business. And what the Supreme Court did was they called them on it. And it's interesting, the Supreme Court actually, in my view, is somewhat political. We acknowledge that the cities have made an important point, but golly gee whiz, we don't want to be the ones that cause the state's budget to crumble right in front of our very eyes. So we'll let that go ahead and happen on its own, and then we'll jump in with the ruling. But here's the real point. Even if it's hold your nose and do this, and the money is not scheduled to come out of the general fund. And yes, we intend to expand. And this city council does have a very consistent track record regardless of who sat on it. They have managed to make every turn every corner, get around every bend when they've had to balance the budget and stay within what they've had to do, whether it's cutting services, whether it's cutting people. So I have no concern about the city's ability to respond. They routinely had. And what we have shown is when we try and make things happen and keep moving, the cities that figure out how to invest in themselves and keep moving forward will be in much better shape on a go-forward basis. Cities that believe in themselves and invest in themselves will come out ahead. So even if we have to pay to opt in and it stinks to high heaven, if it's ultimately in the city's best interest, then it should be done. And we'll deal with the state later. But I, even though this will be not voted on for a week and we'll go ahead and head into closed session, I think it is important to note, because what business does gravitate to is certainty. And so folks who want to know, hey, how's Salinas gonna play this thing? Are they gonna opt in? Are they gonna keep sending the signal open for business and be a community that tries to make things happen within a very important tool? I think this is exactly the right signal to send. Business responds to predictability. And so I'm...
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Sir, could I request that, I know we're hungry, and but it looks like public hearing number three won't take us very long, so these people can get home.
I was just gonna, yes, you can. Are you waiting for the next, okay. Are you waiting for the next item?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Okay, yeah, why don't we do that? Thank you, Tony. I was, we'll go ahead and do that. Who's making the presentation for city? Staff, is it? Courtney is?
Yes.
Well, we're concluding this item, and we're going to go ahead. That's a lot of books for a very expeditious presentation, Courtney.
Do you, Courtney, do you got to get a PowerPoint loaded up? If you give us just 1 minute to get everything loaded up here, Courtney's going to come up and present this to you.
We'll see. We'll see.
Okay. Mayor Donahue, members of the council, here is my short presentation. This is a general plan amendment and a rezone request. It's located at the southwest corner of Laurel and Natividad Road. Looking to the photo on the screen, the site is located just to the south of the existing shopping center. It consists of two lots. This map shows the existing general plan and zoning designations. The red shows retail. Next to it, to the right, is also red showing commercial retail. What this proposal would do, it would change the residentially zoned properties just to the south of the site to match the retail designation just to the north, to match the shopping center site. In terms of analysis, this would not result in a spot zoning situation because it matches the zoning to the north. There are residential uses nearby. This proposal would essentially allow the applicant to proceed with commercial development on this particular site. Through the development review process, compliance of zoning regulations would be required, and those include off-street parking, lighting, noise, landscaping, and signs. We understand from the applicant that the proposal would include construction of a future parking lot. No buildings would be proposed. The parking, from what staff understands, would be provided in order to expand the parking supply at the existing shopping center. The Planning Commission took a look at this proposal on July 20th. They recommended approval. There was some discussion at that hearing. Discussion included the size of the existing center and traffic trip generation. In this particular case, if developed with commercial to the full extent, approximately 280 net trips would be generated, and that's a subtraction of the residential trip generation at maximum density versus the commercial trip generation. The FAR would be approximately 24,000 square feet of development on this particular site. Environmental review, this project was reviewed in accordance with CEQA. A neg deck was prepared, and comments were received from a neighboring property owner. They requested a wall be provided. The zoning code actually requires a wall, so that neighbor's concern is addressed. In conclusion, this proposal found no impacts to the environment or to the surrounding area, and it would be consistent with the general plan and the zoning code policies if approved by council. Staff recommends the council approve the negative deck by resolution, the general plan amendment by resolution, and introduce an ordinance for the rezoning on August 23rd. That concludes staff's presentation.
Oh, he wanted to say something. Go ahead.
Might get a motion right out of the gate.
Yeah, I was going to make a motion.
Do you want to talk?
I just want to thank you for taking the time before your dinner break. My name is Henry Runke. I'm with Wald Runke and Dost Architects. I just wanted to let the council know that we're here as the applicant. I also have the property owner here, and that we'd be available for any questions. And we wanted to thank staff for this, not only today's meeting, but all their help through the Planning Commission and through the staff report process. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your patience. Okay, is there anyone else from the public? Okay, back to Council, Gloria.
I'd like to make a motion.
Second.
Okay.
And I also want to say that the property owner, thank you so much for coming, and that the businesses from that area are going to be so pleased. They are very pleased right now. So yeah. Thank you.
You will not be using styrofoam in any new retail uses, will you? Just checking before I call for the question. What else aren't you supposed to do? And you will apply for redevelopment funds should the opportunity present itself, correct? Okay, now I'll call for the question.
Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yep. Okay, the city manager has assured me we will go through the last item in an expeditious fashion.
Thank you.
Thanks for your patience. Sorry we had to, all right.
Thank you, Matt, for your 30 seconds.
You're welcome. Before you is a culmination of an effort with our bargaining unit, police bargaining units, and as a cost-cutting measure and to control and mitigate future costs, we have an amendment to our PERS retirement contract, and basically it amounts to $4,500 per employee reduction for police and $4,000 for fire. Per year, ultimately, with the 151 police and the 79 fire, that would amount to $1 million a year if all the employees were participating in that program eventually. So it's a long-term strategy for the city as a cost-cutting measure. And that concludes my presentation. Available if you have any questions.
Is this a trick?
Not at all.
It's, how come the rest of them don't do this?
We're going to take the lead from this one.
Okay. I like your reports. You can be on more often. Jim? Okay. Any questions from council? Public?
I can go get dinner. Good evening again. My name is Eric Peterson, and while I'm not in opposition to this, I would like to mention kind of a caution. It wasn't that long ago that the police pay here was perceived as lower than some other areas. Some of those areas had lower costs of living, like Reading, or just plain paid more, and we, the police department was serving as essentially a training ground for other police departments, and this needs to be watched so that doesn't happen again. Thank you.
Good. Thanks, Eric. Okay, anyone else from the public?
Good evening again. This is Hans Jonas. Does anyone of you watches the stock market each day? Nobody, probably. Is the stock market up or down today? It's down again, and pretty soon it will be down further and further and further. CalPERS, where do they get the money from? From the stock market. The money supply is drying up. You know who is getting richer? The guys on Wall Street. You know that. The guys on Washington, you know what Washington DC stands for? District of Crooks. You're gonna end up with no money to pay the pensions. What are you gonna do? I retired at 65. I don't know why these guys can retire at 50 or 55. That's ridiculous. You ought to make up your mind and raise and see the facts, what's happening to this country. Pretty soon, the Chinese will take over. They're already doing it. They have the governor of Idaho given China a piece of land where they can build their own cities, their own industries. What's the matter with that governor? Have you ever looked at when Mr. Obama speaks compared to the previous presidents? When the previous president spoke, there were a bunch of flags, American flags, behind there in the background. When Obama speaks, there's no flags. No. What's hanging there? A Muslim tapestry. Muslim tapestry? Is he a Muslim? He says he is a Christian. What's going on in this country? You read the papers, every country has trouble. You ought to make up your mind and say, this is the pension that you're going to get, and it's less, a lot less than $100,000.
Got it. Thank you, Hans.
And we're not going to pay
you,
for
Hans.
Any charter.
Hans, thank you. Okay, anyone else? Okay, back to council. All right, any final comments?
Mayor.
Yes.
May I start?
Please.
Just want to share for the public's information, even for this council, we're one of the few jurisdictions, if not the only one, where employees pay their own share of employee portion of it, which is 7% for everyone else and 9% for public safety. Some of the negotiations that went on with other jurisdictions had to get them to even pay their share, because everyone else pays it, every other jurisdiction pays for it. So this, we've been thin to begin with, and now, you know, something that the unions have never talked about was, or said they would agree to, is a second tier. And because of the times and because of everything else, they have negotiated something that was very important to the bargaining units and a sacrifice, and they did that. And they did that in cooperation with the city, already paying their own employee portion of it. So this is additionally to provide some flexibility for the city. So just want to recognize their commitment to continue to work with this council and to make sure that the residents still receive the services that they deserve, but to knowingly know that they have been paying their share, while other jurisdictions have not been doing that for other, they pay for their own employees portion. So just want to highlight that for the council.
Thank you, Sir Joe. Jill.
I just want to add to that the county, I believe, has just recently looked at their employees contributing to their costs, their retirement costs, but it's only, what, 3.5%? And we're looking at our employees at 7%, our officers at 9%. And additionally, just to make sure everybody understands, what we're asking police officers to do is to work an additional 5 years. So if we vote no, as the public comment suggests, then what we're doing is we're not moving towards a better sustainability model. So thank you.
So okay, so this, so we will be voting. Okay, all right, Tony.
Mr. Mayor, when we're ready, I'd like to make a motion to amend.
Okay. There's,
second.
Okay, any additional comments? Okay, before we call for the question, just very, very quickly, one of the things that I do want to point out, and I see Steve Furtado here, one of the things that this council was able to accomplish through its the employees in the city, we asked all employee groups to reopen their negotiations. They did not have to do that. They were not legally bound to do that, but they chose to do that. They chose to work with the city, and so as a result of that, we were able to make some progress. So what tonight does reflect is progress and a willingness on the part of employees to acknowledge
the fiscal realities of the city and, frankly, the broader economic conditions in general. So it is important to note this was accomplished because employees agreed to cooperate and work with the city. So with that, let's go ahead and call for the question.
Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember Craig?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
Aye.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yes. Okay, thank you, everyone. We're going to head into closed session. We will be back for each of the next two Tuesdays with equally exciting agendas, and we will look forward to full rotundas and a chance to participate in the deliberative process of representative democracy. Okay.